So we are an internet couple. We met online in the 1990s. And I'm a journalist and a novelist. And Jasmina is an activist and an artist. And we used to hang out on email lists a lot. And I have a history of investigations, and Jasmina here has a history of provocations. So, frankly, we have not changed very much since that time. Even marriage did not change us. I mean, our clothes changed a little bit. You can see Jasmina's wearing her Austin Girl t-shirt here and kind of yankeed out. And I dress like an Italian now. But media has changed a lot. So I want to talk about, differences in media and communication since the late 90s and the current day. And of course, we met during the Balkan difficulties. And I'm interested in these difficulties, not because I'm an activist or, a journalist or a spy or anything exciting. Mostly I'm a novelist and I just want to know where the trouble is. So we went with Share Defense, our groovy hacker friends from Belgrade, over to Kiev a while ago. And Kiev, as you know, recently had a revolution in the Euromaidan. So we were hanging out in Yanukovych's lair with Yanukovych leaks and these other Ukrainian activists. And I ran into some guys there who were from Donetsk, and they were Donetsk Maker Lab guys. And they pointed out that the revolutionaries, the separatists in Donetsk, had shut down their Maker Lab. And as soon as I heard this, I realized, okay, this was the first Maker Lab in the world, which was actually being closed by militants as a political threat. And I thought, okay, this is a hairy situation, and this is gonna get a lot weirder before it gets any straighter. And sure enough, they then proceeded to have a civil war, which is now ongoing. So I want to show you some of the images I have found, in my investigations. And these are not, I didn't leak them, I didn't troll them, I didn't hack them, I'm not even writing about them. Mostly I just found them on search engines and social media, and just through kind of following my nose and using, a little bit of everyday journalistic investigations. So I'm going to show you a few of them and talk about them, and then Jasmina here is going to put them in context. So, I hopefully we'll have a few breakdowns here. Let me just see if my clicker is working. Yeah, it is. Okay. So, this is issue number one, the Yankee troll. And this is probably me, or at least kind of my role model, because this is an American who's involving himself in the difficulties in the Ukraine. And as you can see, he's apparently works for the State Department, because he's got a State Department seal there, and he's got like a screaming eagle on his old-fashioned desktop machine. And he has nothing better to do with his life but to go in and interview and interrupt Russian language political problems, between the Russophone people in the Eastern Ukraine and the Ukrainian-speaking people in their ensuing civil war. So this is, an American sticking his nose in. And I have never met a guy like this. And although there are like thousands of trolls who are like very active in the social warfare that's breaking out in the Ukraine right now, the info war guys, cyber war guys, all kinds of, lies are being spread, rumors, atrocity photos, horrific videos. It's just an amazing thing. I've never met a guy who really seemed to be like an American professional who had Americans' interests in mind in these discussions. And I think they don't exist because the money doesn't work. I mean, there's no American economic model. I mean, if you're really working for the American State Department, you'll pay for spies or public relations people. You'll take over television stations, radio stations. You don't really have money to pay a guy to go out and interrupt Russian social media. It's just like, it's a waste of time of highly paid State Department people. So that sort of leaves the question of like, where do the trolls actually come from? And I think this is where they come from. Yeah. So, here's English language proposal. Ukraine needs you. Get the truth out. Counter Russian propaganda. Tweet, post, email, call. What is this image about? Well, this is for the Ukrainian American diaspora. because, you know, it's Uncle Sam here, except that, you know, of course, it's a Ukrainian poet hero. But the whole thing's being pitched in English, and it's all about English-based social media. It's people using the English language to try to interfere in the English language internet in this ongoing cyber-political info war, cyber war, you know, struggle for public opinion, a struggle for political legitimacy. You know, and an image like this would have been impossible in 1999. There wouldn't have been enough people to see it. It would not have spread virally. It would not have attracted anybody. Nobody would have looked at it and thought, hey, yeah, that's me, man. I'm going to go out and, like, flame some Russians right now. But, you know, clearly tens of thousands of people did, because they really are out there flaming, and they've been recruited through viral imagery of this kind. So, and now Jasmina will say a little something.
Okay, since Bruce talked about how hard it is to be American nowadays, I can tell you how hard it is to be a Serb nowadays, okay? So, I'll start from the fact that I'm a woman, I'm a Serbian woman, and I'm an activist. And this is the centenary of the First World War. So being who I am, I got this question from all over the world. Like, because I live on the internet, I don't have a motherland, I don't have first language, so everybody was asking me, like, what do you think? Was Gavrilo Princip, I mean, the guy who triggered the First World War, actually the guy who killed the Duke, Ferdinand Duke of Austria in Sarajevo 100 years ago, was he a terrorist or was he a patriot? Now, the stupidity of this question drove me crazy because, I mean, it's like the same story. It's like one depends who talks, who asks. You know, for some people, he's a patriot nowadays, and for other people, he's a terrorist. You know, I mean, depends on which side you are. But basically, 100 years later, that question makes no sense, you know. And in order to avoid answering it and also to avoid quarreling with the people who were asking me, because basically what these people were, what people nowadays do regarding First World War, so-called intellectuals, is like projecting their own agenda on the First World War, on this guy, you know, who was just a kid who pulled the trigger for many reasons which I even don't want to go there, because comparison in history does not work. It does not work. It's fake positives, you know. So instead of answering that and fighting them back, I decided to hack the war songs throughout the world, especially the First World War songs. Now, if you ever, you know, I have some kind of background musician, punk musician, but I didn't do it for many years, you know. All of a sudden, I mean, if you go and listen to the war songs from different nations in different languages, you will realize how, you know, how outdated they are. They all speak about victories, about patriots, about terrorists, you know, and I really don't relate to them. No, and they're all written from the man's point of view, meaning from the point of view of a guy who goes to the war. And the woman is sitting back there and crying and come back, please don't die, you know, for my homeland, protect me, my homeland. So what I did is I took those famous war songs one by one as I traveled the world and I hacked them. I wanted the war songs to be famous, so you can recognize them and that you have some patriotic feeling about them. But then I rewrote them from the point of view of women and I kind of staged them with different bands. Depends on which country I was. You know, it was like really random staging. And now I have this album coming up, you know, and I really did Lily from Marlene in Berlin with Brazilian artist called Lily from Belgrade, because this is where the song started. I did the battle hymn called the Hacker Hymn, you will see it. And, you know, Guantanamera, I did Guantanamo Bay. And then Tamo Daleko, this is a Serbian song, I just did it. And it's called, Tamo Daleko means far, far away from Serbia. It's here, here in Serbia. And this is it, you know, I mean, this is what I'm doing in order to stay happier in this world.
So, moving right along in the photos here. Okay, so these are civilian investigators arriving in the battlefields of the Ukraine, pursuing the recent civilian airliner, which fell out of the sky there in small pieces. And, you know, you see a lot of people of this kind showing up in these trouble spots of the world. you can see from the expression on the faces of these Dutch people that they really, really don't want to be there. And it's not just that it's like a horrendous scene and that there are 298 people in pieces and a field full of sunflowers. It's more like the political implications of having to deal with it are so overwhelming for them that it's a very unpleasant duty, and it's something they don't really want to do. However, they really are very much participants. And they've arrived there through the internet for, you know, a lot of the same reasons the people who are on the ground. And these are the people on the ground. These are the warlords, you know, from a couple of weeks ago, who were dominating various areas of eastern Ukraine, the self-proclaimed Donetsk People's Republic and the Luhansk People's Republic. And, you know, these are things that will turn into governments someday if they're left alone. But right now, they're basically revolutionary guys who have started up militias and basically seized certain areas of gang turf and accumulated heavy weapons. And it's not hard to follow them. I mean, they're actually easier people to follow than the Dutch investigators. The Dutch investigators who showed up have said pretty much nothing about what they found. They took the black box, they went home, they're not on media. Every one of these guys has a huge social media profile and all kinds of fandom, especially Strelkov, but really every one of them. And it's not hard to find out that these allegedly mysterious warlords are in fact the former owner of a grocery store chain and an ex-funeral director and, you know, a radical right-wing political writer and a retired Russian military guy who writes fantasy novels. That's really who they are, you know? I mean, they're people who were just more or less everyday people before hell arrived in the corner of their world, and now they have reconnaissance groups, sabotage groups, self-proclaimed battalions, strike forces, they have artillery, they have missiles, they can shoot an airliner out of the sky. Probably one of them did it. Nobody knows which one. Everybody's been speculating about it. I don't think even the warlords themselves know. Sometimes they resign, sometimes new one shows up. They'll have cousins, they have brothers, girlfriends, ex-wives. They're real human beings, and it's actually easier to follow them than it is to follow these guys. You know, and the guy here in the balaclava is, of course, you know, the devotee of one of these warlords. Nobody knows quite whom. That's why he's got the balaclava. But these are actually, they're rather mysterious people. These guys are actually quite open and above board, right, by comparison. And they have never been so close. They have never been so united in social networking than they are right now. You will see them in the same searches. You will see them in the same situations. You know, they show up in the same videos. I mean, one will talk to another. It's just not like it was. And now Jasmina will come.
Well, this is going to be about journalists, foreign journalists reporting on a war on the ground, on a local war. So I worked for New York Times, for Washington Post, for Philadelphia Inquirer, especially during the 90s, during the war. And I had, you know, often when you have foreign journalists coming to your country, which is like in the war, you know, or something like that, because wars are not as they used to be. You know, nowadays you don't even know. Like Serbia was never officially in war, but we really were the aggressors of all the other countries, you know, around us. And they would like come, they were often journalists for the region, meaning they couldn't tell the difference, you know, between Czechoslovakia or Yugoslavia, you know. They were not like ignorant people, but they just didn't have to know that before they were sent into the region. You know, I even once had a question from this journalist who came, and I was like his translator, his Beatrice, his Virgilio to Dante, you know, I was taking him to the hell slow steps, you know. I had a question, how many black people do you have? And I was like, black people? He said, that, why are you fighting the civil war? You know, I'm like, no. He couldn't tell the difference between the Croats and Serbs and Bosnians, you know, we all look the same, you know, so why are you fighting the war? What kind of war is it? Is it ethnic war? Is it religious war? Is it, you know, I mean, whatever, you know, they couldn't tell any difference. So at this point, I decided to make a book. And now this is like really, really, really interesting as far as internet is concerned. At that point, you know, we were not really connected Yugoslavia fell apart, and we were completely disconnected. We couldn't communicate, not even to our family. And the press was horrid, especially in Serbia. I mean, it was like they were telling lies. Nobody was buying that stuff, you know. At that point, a group of activists, a Dutch group of activists, put up an internet network called For Peace, Zamir. And it connected us, you know, it really connected us. So we started, especially women, because I'm not saying women are inherently better than men, but, you know, by number, maybe they are. I won't be essentialist, maybe. But anyway, they don't fight the war. They stay at home and they have different issues. They have issues of survival and of pulling the trigger and having those kind of problems or being killed, you know. So at that point, what they have is to communicate and to see what's going on and where to get food. And so basically, through this kind of Zamir for Women, peace, we connected. And I collected the stories because the ultimate victims of or displaced people of every war, apart from the soldiers who are really going there, are 80% are women and children, because it's them who really have to move, for refugees who are being, harassed in many, many terrible ways. But they also are staying on the ground, and they tell the stories just as they are. I mean, they don't go telling you who is right, who is wrong, who did. They don't speak like newspapers. They're not very ideological. They're much more concrete. And what I wanted from these people, refugees, they're mostly women, I wanted them to tell their own story in their own words, meaning to tell me what happened in their own house, in their own village, in their own town to them, to tell me the truth, meaning was it the neighbor who came and tried to kill them, rape them, whatever? Was it a paramilitary troop that came to their town and did it? Whatever they knew, whatever they see. I collected those stories thanks to internet and thanks to women's groups all over, because we wanted to stay together. We wanted to stay connected. I knew about genocide in Srebrenica 2 days after it was done through my friends in Srebrenica, who told me, look, they're doing it. Nobody was telling us about that. And then that book became some kind of map of war crimes in former Yugoslavia, which was not an official thing. But my journalists, when they came there, it was published by California University Press in 96, before the Kosovo war. And they were like reading it, and they could really have a better insight of what was really going on the ground, far better than the political, philosophical, sometimes very highbrow philosophers, which really could not stand water compared to the reality on the ground and some honest reporting.
So, how is this working out over there in the Ukraine? This is a quite typical kind of propaganda thing from the pro-rebel side. And, you know, here you have people who are trying to establish a new nation, the People's Republic of Donetsk. This actually is from Donetsk, but there's also the People's Republic of Donetsk, and they may both become a new country called Novo Russia. Nobody really knows. I mean, they're literally making it up as they go along. But they have to rewrite history in order to justify themselves as a nation and a kind of historical entity. So there's a lot of this internet history hacking going on. People are just feverishly seizing past historical images, kind of photoshopping them, hacking them, turning them inside out, combining them in new ways, trying to legitimize themselves. But the thing that really interests me about this image in particular is, okay, here we've got four, you know, fighter groups from the same area of the world, and they look completely different, except for the last guy. And the last guy there is just a typical guerrilla in the current guerrilla war in Nova Russia. But he looks exactly like his enemy. In fact, they all go out and they dress in masks, and commonly they just sort of wear any uniform they can find. He's a global guerrilla, and he has no distinct look at all. He looks exactly like the enemy Ukrainian troops. In fact, he looks exactly like American troops deployed in Iraq, or he looks exactly like people in Syria or like people in Libya or anywhere else. He's got a completely anonymous outfit. He doesn't have even so much as a flag or a ribbon or, you know, a unit badge. Nothing. He's like a completely anonymous global product. And yet he supposedly He's the product of this historical development, right? I mean, you can't tell him from anybody else with a gun. He could be from Walmart, right? He's like the McDonald's burger of international fighters. He just looks completely like everybody else in the world. And, you know, and this is his boss, Strelkov, Igor Girkin. You know, and Igor Girkin is actually the mastermind of historical hacking in this region. Girkin happens to be a Russian guy, but he's a Russian military historian. So he's by far the most popular of the warlords because he's the best at playing historical dress up. He's literally done it for years. That's him on the right-hand side there, the guy with his sword upraised. This is Girkin, who's a Muscovite, pretending to be a Roman centurion. He's also dressed up as, you know, a revolutionary, Napoleonic Russian fighter. He's dressed himself up as a World War I fighter on a number of occasions. Sometimes he goes up dressed out as an anti-fascist guy from World War II. He's making up the flags, he's inventing the badges, and he has crowdsourced fans, many of them historical reenactors themselves, who help him make this stuff up. He's actually got a fandom of people online who will like answer his stuff. They like make badges for him. They, you know, they distribute his propaganda for him. I mean, he's the most imaginative of the warlords because he really does have the biggest historical imagination. The only thing is, he doesn't really have an era. He's not a modern person at all. And he dresses in kind of anything that he likes. It's really a fantastic development, this kind of history hacking. I mean, even in the Balkans in the 1990s, where everybody was busily rediscovering their ethnic and historical identities, you didn't have anything like this kind of complete fluidity. I mean, if you were Croat, you were like actually Croat, sort of, kind of. These guys, I mean, this is a guy who's a Novorussian who's not even from the area. I mean, he's not Ukrainian. He's a Muscovite guy, and he spent most of his time fighting. Well, he spent some time fighting in Bosnia. He was in Syria. He was in Libya for a while. He's a global fighter. He's a military adventurer. But he's just plain invented it. And he's a novelist. He's a fantasy novelist like me. You know, and his deputy defense director in the Republic of Donetsk, in fact, is a Ukrainian science fiction writer, a guy named Fedor Berezin, who's written a dozen novels about the future of war, nuclear war, missile exchanges, guerrilla wars. The guy's chief of staff is a military science fiction writer. It's quite astonishing. And you know, why is it happening now? It's because social media has allowed it to happen. It's because the images move faster, the video moves faster. It's because clubs of people can unite in new ways. It's a different form of ideological struggle over warfare. It's something that's really, you know, I find it hard to describe, but I know this is happening. It's like new and dangerous. Just a new dangerous thing in the world.
Okay, speaking about this dangerous, I call it the globalization of militarization, because I have very concrete experience when as I mentioned, the genocide in Srebrenica, and in 2005, a video was discovered of this paramilitary group shooting the civilians, the Bosnian, some underage civilians, and they were arrested thanks to this virally spread video, because people were wanted to see it, and they shot it because they were proud of it. Huh? And so it went on the internet, and they were arrested, and there was a trial in downtown Belgrade, and I was living there at the time. We were both living there. I went to follow the trial for a year and a half. It was a public trial, but trust me, there was nobody to watch that, which was beyond Shakespeare. It was beyond Shakespeare. We were sitting in a small room and seeing these guys who pulled the trigger, and they were in cold-blooded guys, you know, like they were like shaved. They could be anybody, paramilitary. It could have been like, you know, from Latin America to Americans. That's the way they look, that's the way they talk. And on the other side, we had the mothers of the shot people, Bosnian women, you know, who came, and women in black, activists. I'm part of them, you know, I'm one of the group. But I was the only writer who came there, and wrote about it. This was like amazing because I was expecting a lot of writers and historians to sit there and watch that and take. You had only to put down the words they were saying. There was nothing else to add. That was history, you know. And while I was writing it, on blogs. You know, it was like a Serbian big blog, and in Serbian. And I was writing it in English also, so went on Boing Boing and many, many other well-read blogs, widely, you know, really. And what happened at that point, that I was getting hate mail from all over the world, from paramilitary from all over the world. And the language was exactly the same. They were saying, you bitch, you woman, what would you know about honor, about men, about men who are fighting for their own, for the families, to defend the country, to defend your homeland. I mean, they were like hate mail, like all of a sudden you had American paramilitary supporting the Serbian scorpions, you know, and Latin American paramilitary. And I started collecting that, you know. I started collecting that, and Charlotte Bunch is like, I don't know, you probably know of her. She's like this famous feminist, and she writes a book, theoretician. She wanted me to collect that, and she was using it for UN report on on globalized hate mail, you know. But as Bruce was saying, what I'm against women, misogyny, but what Bruce was pointing out, that's what I realized on my body, really, on me, they were picking up, is that they really had the same language, the same attitude. It was a, and they had this political position, which was basically nothing invented. They were going from one war zone to another. They're professional fighters, killers, idiots, you know, dangerous, dangerous, dangerous. They had no humanity left in that. They believed that they were like those people who they invented themselves to be, you know.
Yeah, so, you know, let's have a look at women, because that's actually an interesting topic. You know, in former warfare, you actually had these kind of military classes of guys who would go out and fight on the battlefield, and they had esprit de corps, and, you know, and they shared their honor with the enemy. In fact, if your enemy has honor, that makes you more honorable. But the thing that's interesting about this sort of social media war or these struggles online is that, you know, women are at least half the population. On a battlefield, women are either victims or nurses or hookers or, you know, whatever. There aren't very many really armed Amazon troops out there shooting. But online, you know, the women are a major deal, and they're a big deal. So here's a woman in the Donetsk People's Republic who's posing with the, you know, recently invented Donetsk People's Republic flag, and she's got an automatic weapon. So, you know, what's this about? Well, you know, she's from Donetsk or somewhere in the region, and this is, you know, basically military pinup material. She's not a female soldier, otherwise she'd be wearing a bulletproof vest and, you know, a helmet like, say, Israeli female soldiers. And she doesn't really intend to go out and shoot anybody because she's wearing, like, spike heels and she's got a hairdo. I mean, you know, she might break a fingernail if she actually was, like, trying to use this weapon. But it's a very successful image in that it's meant to be virally propagated. It's like, hey, look at this hot chick from the DPR, man. She's like a girl in thigh-high boots with a weapon. That's for me. You know, and then also, you know, it's meant to be propagated among women as, hey, wow, look at these girls in the DPR who are, like, not kidding around. And here's another version of this. This is an actual woman who is a fighter. She's a fighter pilot for the Ukrainian military group. She got shot down behind enemy lines, taken prisoner, and removed into Russia, where she's now in captivity. So this is, you know, Nadia. Nadia, the photogenic prisoner of war. So you'll notice they're not actually asking the Russians to get Nadia out, because otherwise this would be written in Russian. On the contrary, they're using Nadia in English for the viral aspects of the campaign. It's like, let's liberate this suffering hero woman. You know, it's an appeal to the internet's heartstrings. It's like, our darling, she's in prison somewhere, she's dark, it's menaced. Okay, she's, you know, there are a lot of man prisoners in this thing too. They don't have any such campaigns. They're probably women who've been abducted. God only knows where they are, but they're not pretty. They don't capture the public imagination like Nadia does. Here's a young woman who happened to be near the plane crash site. So she was wandering through the debris of the 298 Dutch and Malaysian passengers, and she found a makeup case. She went home, put on the makeup, and did a selfie of herself, and is immediately denounced as a terrorist. Even mascara isn't safe in a cyber war. Even a selfie photo can be seized and used as a method of demonization. She's a teenage girl who looted a crash site, and you know, and immediately this image is seized upon, probably by a woman, and then spread in order to make the enemy look bad. And here's what's rapidly become a kind of a nice gesture in Donetsk and Luhansk, the military wedding, commonly on YouTube videos. This is a woman who married a guerrilla in the Vostok Battalion, which is one of the warlord groups. But she was one of the first people married legally or under the legal auspices of the Donetsk People's Republic. So there have been 7 of these state weddings in which people sort of gather and agree to be married by a state which doesn't really exist. And then in her wedding finery, she gets onto the armored vehicle and they drive around town in a kind of wedding procession, right? This has happened 7 times. And they're all available on YouTube. They're not hard to find. They're in fact public military propaganda weddings. You know, the first ones were really remarkable. Now they're becoming quite routine. In fact, even the Ukrainians are beginning to do it. They're beginning to marry military people and publicize the marriages. You never saw this earlier. You see plenty of wartime marriages. Believe me, people in wartime will marry at the drop of a hat. I mean, war is very romantic. People really, really want to marry. They didn't marry on social media for political purposes. This is a new thing in the world.
Well, during the Balkan Wars in Serbia, we had this connubio, as you say in Italian, the marriage between a war criminal and his darling Ceca singer, Arkan, who was the paid paramilitary, first by ex-Yugoslav regime and then by Milosevic. He was like Arkan in his tiger. He's famous for his cruelties and mass murders all over former Yugoslavia. So at a certain point, he married this young turbo folk singer, and it was horrible. It was a public wedding all over Serbia that became like the role model for many, many public. It was, of course, on YouTube and the shootings and that there were, and she was like, she was basically more famous than he was at the time, but she made, with her pop fame, you know, she made his killing famous. You know, it's really, it was amazing how they did this bad service. They stole our imagery, you know, to young people. They stole it, they polluted it. They really killed my mind, you know. And what I want to say that in those years when Ceca was and her music was playing loud in all the cafes, it still is, by the way, you know, but not as much, you know. At that time, it was like our children were listening to that. Our children were growing with that, you know. Our kids were dancing, not knowing. And I would always remember the sound of guns and how many people he killed and raped, the guy. And she was saying it in her song. She was quoting it, like, my bad guy, he's the worst, but I love him, I'm his victim, that kind of stuff, you know. But at that same time, we had in Serbia, women in black in Serbia. They started from a scratch, you know. There were women, and they were trying to implement some other different culture. And right now, what we have in Israel, women in black from Israel. And what are they doing? If you don't know the principle of women in black, it's the most updated and most positive pacifist principle in the history of pacifism, which is a huge history. For thousands of years, pacifism has existed. And that is, you will go against your own military. It's too easy to go against the other. So what are doing the women in Israel right now? I want to support them really heavily. They're risking their lives every day. They're standing in front of their own military and say, you're not gonna shoot the Palestinians. The same thing the Palestinian women in black are doing in front of their own military. The same thing the Serbian women are doing in front of their own military during the 90s, saying, you know what? I can stop my husband, I can stop my son if I stand with my body in front of him. I can't stop the other. But if you do this, maybe you can make a difference. And one of the songs I'm doing these days is exactly doing it from the point of view of an Israel woman right now in Gaza.
You know, it's easy to look at a situation like that in Donetsk and Lugansk and think, okay, well, you know, there must be something special about these people, which is why something, you know, so bad is happening there. I don't really think that's the truth at all. I mean, nobody was really expecting any particular trouble out of this part of the world, although it is close to the Caucasus and, you know, like many parts of the world, it's had a long history of military problems. Nobody who was really interested in geopolitics expected the eastern Ukraine to flare up. You know, and what's happening there could go away, if they were lucky, in a matter of weeks. But then it would flare up somewhere else. I mean, what's happening in this area is a thing that is like typical of global society. It's not a unique Ukrainian situation, by no means. And in fact, it's trying its best to spread. So this is the Ukrainian Foreign Legion, basically, the recently formed Azov Battalion. So, you know, the Azov Battalion, unlike the French Foreign Legion used to be, is actually kind of increasingly web savvy. So here you can just click onto the old Azov Battalion website, and if you'd like to increase the struggle in the Ukraine, you just like toss in some money. It's like a Kickstarter thing, you know, it's just like transfer us some bucks. And I was like, and it doesn't really matter who you are or where you came from. If you're Russian, you can contribute. You know, to see Russians killed. I mean, maybe you're in Lugansk and for some reason you want to blow up your own town, that you can give them money anyway. You know, the money can arrive from any source. It doesn't matter. Virgin Islands, you know, they're not picky. Their backs are against the wall. Bitcoin would be fine with them. You know, anything you want to use, you know, any regional currency. So you can fund them. You can fund them from anywhere on the planet. And you can do your little bit to make sure there's more bloodshed in that region. Or you can join them. And that's even more enticing. I mean, maybe you're some guy watching these warlords, and you're thinking, you know, my life's here pretty boring. I was thinking about joining a hackerspace. I don't really have a job. But you know what? I'm going to go out and just shoot some people. You can do it. I mean, the chance of your getting back in one piece is quite low. You're really likely to be killed going there or arrested coming back, especially arrested coming back. But they will recruit you, and they're not fussy. They don't care if you're Polish, if you're a Nazi, if you're a communist, if you're gay, nobody's gonna ask. You could be white, black. They're recruiting in English. You don't have to speak Ukrainian. It's just a temptation. They'll give you, you know, 1,200 euros a month. You'll have a gun, a uniform. You're pretty well guaranteed to see combat. If you want to fight in a global war, you could be a global guy and go fight. And this is new. I mean, it's been intensifying. They're always mercenaries. They're mercenaries in all wars, historically for a long time. But there's never been this kind of like, let's hop on EasyJet and go for it kind of situation. This is really new. You know, and anybody can get involved. Like, oh wait, I don't really want to fight. I want to be a hacker. And I was like, I want to like learn to program. Okay, that's what the recruiting sign on this bus station says. When I saw this, I actually looked it up. It's not hard to do. Lugansk info. Okay, yeah. They actually want to take you off the street, give you computer training, and give you a job, and you get to put on your tie, and you have your laptop, and you know, you're gonna be like working on Wi-Fi installations, maybe doing a router, unless you happen to be standing in the bus at the stop when a 220-millimeter artillery shell goes off and the bus station is blown to pieces and there you are, suddenly dead while waiting for the bus. Okay, the mere fact that we talk about it, that we're online, you know, that we're having internet romance, that doesn't mean she and I can't get blown up, or you or anybody else. It's just, you know, the danger is sort of omnipresent at this point. There are certain areas where it's congealed, but we're all adding to it. And the net is right there everywhere that this problem is. And the mere fact that you join the internet does not make you bulletproof from this other kind of problem. On the contrary, they become the same kind of problem because that's the kind of society we have. Okay, soon Jasmina is going to play one of her songs for you. But I want to just conclude with this last photo, because I think this sort of sums it up in a way I never will. And then after that, I'll say nothing, and Jasmina will explain some of her stuff and play this video. Okay, but this is the last, and I've saved it for best, because this is kind of the pièce de résistance. The cute terrorist viral puppy. Yeah, he's lol dog. He's like the cute viral puppy separatist armed gorilla. And, you know, an actual, say, this dog belongs to an actual separatist armed gorilla. A guy who's out in the camo, and he's wearing the balaclava mask. But he had to dress up his dog as a global gorilla and then let the dog loose as the viral cute dog. And, you know, not just the Russian internet, but the internet loves this dog. He's a super popular dog. He's just like caught people's attention. He's kind of the Grumpy the Cat of global, you know, pet hate, whatever. But, you know, that is the level that it's reached. And it's no accident that it's like this. I mean, the owner of this dog understands why this is funny. It is funny. It's deadly, but it's also funny. It's popular because it's funny and also deadly. I mean, the deadliness has reached the level of lol cats. They're the same thing. And we're going to see more of that. It's a fascinating thing to watch. It's not the end of the world. It's just how the world is now. That's how it is. You know, and I don't really have an opinion about it. Well, I don't offer any particular cure for the situation. I'm a novelist. My feeling is about it. What seems to be the trouble here? This is the trouble. This is what the trouble seems to be. There he is. That's it. Okay? Now, Jasmina.
Well, I'll stay on the more positive side of sharing things on the internet, because like 30 years ago when I sold a script to the mainstream cinema, you know, in Rome, and I got a lump sum, which was huge, for, and I was very young. And instead of buying a flat, I didn't have a flat, I didn't have anything, a job or a flat, I bought myself equipment to be an independent filmmaker. Nobody had it, you know, I mean, at the time. And I put up a scene in Rome, in Belgrade, where we're shooting our video. I mean, it was the cost of a flat, really, you know. And many years later, I said, why didn't I buy a flat when I was living, you know, in very bad places, in somebody places, you know. And then nowadays, I mean, the equipment I'm using for making my video, making my music, I couldn't even buy 1 square meter anywhere in the world, not even in Belgrade. It's really cheap, you know, nowadays. Meaning, and I'm really happy that I can be an independent filmmaker, that I get my own music. I mean, this album I need, that I'm finishing this month, you know, I'm already offered, people want me to make a concert. They wanted to produce an album even before I had 2 songs, you know. And I'm doing it without budget. All the musicians kick in. They want to do it for free. I have no money, but, you know, they say, we're honored to do it. And I said, I'm not really a musician. Never mind, nobody's a musician anymore, which is true, you know. Nobody's a professional musician. The industry has fallen, you know. And the thing is, like, I will show you, I will play you this video, which is the most... the best one for this kind of crowd, you know, because they're all different videos. I did one in Donetsk also, you know, in Ukraine, for Ukraine. And it is like really self-produced, self-made. And what's really good about it is like, I wouldn't call it viral, but people have translated it, people have played it, people have invited me to play it, you know, all over the world. And it's growing, you know, it's like, and this is like, and also women have been using another song I did, Bella Ciao, called Bello Ciao, meaning from the point of view of a woman saying, don't go to fight a war, be a brave deserter. Now that was translated in so many languages and was used as a hymn in feminist conferences. I mean, and anybody can do a song like this, you know, it's not only me. And you just have to do it, just do it, for heaven's sake. And this is the new technology, and this is the positive side of which I'm using. I know we're living in a big bad world, you know, but I think we have to survive. Okay, so let's do it. Let's play it.
Mm-hmm. And I have seen the misery of the coming cyber wars. My heart had felt the sorrow of young lives yet to fall. My mind has been corrupted with the garbage cyber trolls and the drones come buzzing on. Roly poly evil Google boy, roly poly baby Facebook toy, roly poly spy and a NSA boy, and the drones come buzzing on. Yeah, the codes and the drones of the spying internet lords have trampled over fields of our software joys. Facebook, Google Glasses, NSA devices, trolls, and the lies are marching on. Yeah, roly poly, evil Google toy. Glory, glory, Google deserter boy. Roly poly, evil Facebook boy, and the lies are marching on. I have seen my boys become the soldiers of war. I have lost my cyber sons to patriotic trolls. I am the mother of the victims of the lies who deserted the wicked spy. Yeah! Glory, glory, Google deserter boy. Glory, glory, Facebook deserter toy. Glory, glory, NSA defector boy. And the truth comes marching. I have seen the rising of the brave NSA spies. I have seen the rebellion for the freedom of the toys. My eye have seen the glory of the coming of the hacks, and the lies don't march no more. Yeah! Glory, glory, hacker, NSA boy. Glory, glory, hacker, NSA girl. Lies won't march no more.